or so.
Sure.
Please allow us another 5 minutes because we have that kind of time and 12
Actually,
o'clock.
yeah, it's streaming live.
Yeah. And
Yes,
Guruji, I think you have been introduced to Professor Hitesh Shukla, sir. Yeah. So, sir is also associated with Ouro University, specifically for the very prestigious program that we are running, that is PG Diploma in Family Managed Business. And that is being taken care of by Dr. Tanu as program coordinator. So,
lovely.
Dr.
Hi,
Shukla
Professor
is actually
Hitesh.
mentoring this program, and we hope that he'll keep mentoring too in future as well. Yeah.
Thank you, madam.
So I'd like to inform my panelists and my audience also. We already have 200 plus audience with us right away, that we are also streaming live on YouTube. I will just share the link with our panelists in case you want to share the same in your circles. In a minute I will do that. And please allow us audience and panelists another minute or two so that before we begin.
So, ma'am, you're catching up from?
I'm from Delhi. I'm here in my home in Delhi.
Okay, great. Yeah, nice. And I hope, Shukla sir, you're catching up from Ahmedabad.
Madam, I'm from Rajkot.
Rajkot. Yeah. Presently, you are from Rajkot only?
I'm right now, I'm based at Rajkot.
Rajkot. Okay. So then it is already 12, so I think we can commence. Yeah.
Okay, ma'am, thank you for your permission. A very good afternoon, one and all. I welcome each one of you today for an enthralling session on the topic that we have with us, which is path-breaking panelists on board with us. Before we begin, as per the Ouro tradition, requesting all to observe 2 minutes concentration for Guru Vandana. Please, may I request Manish ji at Ouro end to play the Guru Vandana. Okay, so friends, today I would like to begin by expressing our solicitude and complete empathy towards the crisis our country is undergoing, but also would like to express great faith and confidence that soon we will all come out of the situation and move towards the path of victory. In order to demonstrate the same spirit, we at Oro are constantly working towards organizing such path-breaking events to build the confidence of a society in large. Today is one such event where we have with us the daughters of the prominent family businesses who have not only inherited the business, but also taken it to another heights. Also joining them, we have two eminent personalities who have done superior and astounding work in the field of family business research and mentoring. Under the aegis of Family Business Program, we, School of Business, have organized this two-day talk series on the theme of redefining gender in family businesses, daughters taking the legacy forward. The objective is to inspire and motivate our students and scions of the family businesses by listening to the perfect examples set by our panelists. Moving forward, I would like to invite our head of department, Dr. Monica Suri, to come forward and introduce the School of Business at Oro University. Ma'am.
Thank you, Tanu. And before I give the introduction of School of Business and Oro University, I would like to congratulate both of the coordinators, Dr. Tanu Narang and Ms. Karen Kambata, my colleagues from School of Business, for giving us this platform wherein we are meeting the galaxy of speakers to whom we read in books and articles and, you know, at various digital marketing resources. So I think it's a proud day for us that we are having extreme galaxy of speakers with us. And on behalf of our Honorable Vice Chancellor and our Dean, Honorable Dean, Dr. Rohit Singh, I would like to once again welcome all the speakers on the dais today for extended 2 days of very special talk, which Tanu has already briefed about. So it is indeed my honor to introduce you all to School of Business, Oro University. So many of the participants who have joined are already aware of Oro University. They have been introduced, but my introduction is for those who are being introduced to Oro University School of Business for the first time. So Oro University was established in the year 2011 under Gujarat Private State Universities Act with two schools, that is School of Hospitality and School of Business initially. And the university is founded by Rama family, who are actually entrepreneurs and hoteliers. And basically they are an infrastructure group specifically in hospitality industry. And they are based in Navsari, one of the villages from Surat. And since last many years, they are in US. And they are also expanding their horizons in terms of their hospitality sector, hotel industry specifically. And they established this university based on the founding principles of Sri Aurobindo and Divine Mother. Because Mr. Rama is a follower of Sri Aurobindo and Divine Mother. And he wanted to come up with such kind of educational institution wherein the values should be practiced as the topmost priority, because today we are struggling hard in businesses, not because of any technical aspects or operational aspects. I think the values are at times deteriorating. So because of that aspect, our main focus is on how to strengthen the physical, mental, vital, and spiritual aspects of all the stakeholders, largely students and faculty who are joining Oro University. And Oro University, we are expanding year after year. We call ourselves as progressive, not because we are number one, but because we are upgrading ourselves year after year by getting more value additions in every aspect of our teaching learning process, in terms of our industry collaborations, in terms of our community outreach activities. And this is what Oro University stands for. And as I said, that we have global reach as well. Almost 23 MOUs we have with foreign universities and industry. Naming few are University of Northampton, University of Rome, University of Italy, and many more to come on board with us. At the same time, we have very strong industry collaborations wherein we have collaborated with Gift City, and we formalized the relationship by signing MOU with them, so that we all know that GIFT City is the first smart city model inaugurated by our Honorable Prime Minister of India. And on same lines, he's coming up with many other smart city townships across our country. So we signed MOU with them as well, so that our students should also get opportunity to get employed in GIFT City in various aspects and in various domains of specializations. Along with that, we have very strong interaction with industry, wherein we have advisory boards on place, so that we should not have any gap between industry and academia. Because generally we have heard that, you know, there's a big gap between industry and academia. When students are coming out from the university, there's always a gap that whatever has been taught is very different from whatever has been implemented. So to overcome this gap also, Aura University is facilitating 20-30-50 principle, teaching learning principle, in which we believe that 20% they learn by listening, 30% they learn by seeing, and 50% is learning by doing. So on this philosophy and model, we are actually aligned to this very special teaching pedagogy, which is truly aligned to the integral approach to education, which actually Sri Aurobindo dreamt of. Along with that, we have at School of Business, when we talk about School of Business, obviously I can go on and on to introduce School of Business, but I'll just briefly tell you about some of the important features of School of Business, that what we stand for. Though, as I've already introduced you to Aura University, so School of Business is equally aligned to the vision and mission of Aura University of integral and transformational approach to learning. So we are also strengthening all the programs in such a way wherein, rather than making them the wonderful number one marketing, HR, operation, or maybe finance professionals, we want them to be first good human beings. So this is what is missing in industry and across the globe. So we want them to be strengthened in physical, mental, vital, and spiritual aspect. And School of Business is largely evolving with a very special teaching pedagogy, that is simulation-based pedagogy. Other than case study methodology, group discussions, and other methodologies of teaching, we are finding simulation-based teaching methodology very effective in all the programs, across the programs of School of Business. And for that, we have very special association with IMA, All India Medical Management Association, wherein they established IMA BizLab at Aura University campus, which actually gives hands-on real-time problems and challenges that industry is facing. And it is basically a virtual simulation where students are owning that particular simulation as owners and stakeholders, and they're running that simulation to overcome all the challenges of the industry. And that has been aligned to various modules of marketing, human resource, operations, technology, supply chain management, business analytics. So all these aspects are completely aligned. So we are finding it very effective, and I'm proud to share that on the wall of fame of IMA, our students are coming in top three since last three consecutive years, since the time we have collaborated with them. So this simulation-based learning actually is helping our students a lot. Along with that, we have received a grant of more than 1 crore rupees under Student Startup Innovation Policy Scheme through Government of Gujarat, which is actually promoting entrepreneurial management education amongst our students. And our students are promoted to come up with some kind of startup and entrepreneurship activities, because as when you see largely our demographic of students, they are coming from family-owned backgrounds. So I see them as job creators rather than job seekers. So this is basically the demographic of School of Business students. And with this, we have a very strong industry interface. Advisory boards are on place. And you know that this tough time is there in front of all of us, wherein we are in the process of restructuring the curriculum so that we should make our students market ready, industry ready. So for that, we have already in the process of revamping the curriculum with the help of academicians like Professor Shukla, and also from the industry experts and leaders who should actually guide us how to update our curriculum for next 4 or 5 years span of time, so that our students should be employable and they should become the first choice and preference of any industry. So these were some of the USP. As I said, I can go on and on to talk about School of Business, but in due course of time, I have to restrict myself here. But I request all the audience and participants who have joined, you can explore more about our university later on. And especially, I would like to have a special mention about PGD FMB program, under which Dr. Tanu and Karen are coordinating this webinar. And that is, again, a very special program, and which has actually very unique features of coming up with very experiential pedagogy, wherein we are not taking the already existing case studies only. We are also taking the case studies of those students who are getting enrolled in the particular family business, that if they are having any problem in any of the aspect of their business, they can bring their problems and challenges in the classroom. Specifically, we have kept boardroom for them, not the classroom, because they're going to be future CEOs. So we want to give them ambience of, you know, a boardroom, so that they should feel responsible and accountable to take all the responsible decisions on behalf of their family business. So, I mean, this is all about School of Business very briefly. And I thank Tanu for giving me this platform to introduce the legacy of School of Business and Oro University. And it's—
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, for introducing the School of Business. And now that we already have a 400 plus audience waiting to listen to our panelists today, moving forward, I would like to first invite and extend my invitation to our first panelist of the day, Professor Hitesh Shukla, who is advisor to many family businesses and business houses across India, Asia, USA, and UK. He advises and specializes in the areas of family constitution, succession planning, and his case studies have been published in Harvard Business Publishing Houses, and we're extensively using that in our curriculum. He is, as already mentioned, closely associated with Oro University, particularly the PGD FMB program, mentoring us on the way forward. Sir, the platform is all yours.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, but I'm just although the flow has already been shared, all panelists have 20 minutes, and then we'll open the floor for our audience for the interaction. All yours, sir.
Thank you, Tanu. Thank you very much for this opportunity, Oro University and all the authorities. Daughters taking the legacy forward. What my observation is, you know, family business is describing hope, dream, ambition, relationship, personal struggle are the great legacy that want to live proudly by the next generation. The next generation may be a boy, girl. I will not restrict myself only to the daughters, but I will include in my talk daughter-in-law too. All right. The successful family businesses passes on values and reason for generations. And leadership in family business is a responsibility, not only to the business, but also to the family. It is all about managing trust, maintaining transparency, communication with stakeholders. How daughters are taking the legacy forward, not in terms of inherent business, but how they are earning the business and passing on to the next generation. What I've learned is, you know, it's your responsibility to pass on your business to the next generation. As a leader, that is your responsibility. I would like to start my talk with one of the line that I always read. Whatever books you are reading, whatever articles you are reading on family business, one line we will always see in the article or in the books that describe family business as pop and mom store. What the word, what the definitions they are writing is pop and mom store. A team of husband and wife doing business for the livelihood is termed as family business. That indicates wife as invisible leader of business. I would like to add here that the wife is the first advisor to the husband. And that gives a direction that has a very, very positive impact on the business. And the success of a family business depends on the success of the family. And the family is always led by the woman. where woman plays a great role in managing togetherness, harmony, and sustainability. A woman is an administrator of the family, managing personal finance, preserving wealth. The woman is the central personality of the family circle, managing resources, and very importantly, grooming the next generation, maintaining culture and values in the family business. A woman has a high impact and influence on the business. She is considered as a CEO, Chief Emotional Officer of the family, who plays a vital role in family council, the next generation woman, who may be a daughter or daughter-in-law, is overcoming socially and cultural barriers and redefining her role as the front runner. Traditionally, a woman was invisible leader, as I said, of the family business, but today, she becomes the business face. She took the charge of board of directors, responsible owner, and family employee in their own family business. The next generation woman is integrating personal, professional, and family values to empower leadership. Conventionally, woman is leading family council, taking care of every individuals, understanding the needs and wants of members of the family, and try to satisfy them. Woman played a critical role in resolving conflict in family and businesses. Many times, she created a breach between generations. The woman was considered shock absorber in the family, a live wire for communication that encourages communication among the unsatisfied family members. Women are considered holistic leader and guiding principle for the family. Earlier, she was given a softer role in CSR activities, philanthropy, and then to HR. But now, they are leading strategic decisions and operational across the industry. The most important change within the family business has been this significant increase of women in management, in ownership. Women were not usually considered to head the business, especially in countries and culture that had male dominated. With this background, let us see some fact. I would like to put here some data before you all. According to a study by Mass Mutual Finance Group USA, they surveyed in 2007, 24% sample family business had a woman CEO, which was 10% in 2002 and just 2% in 1994. Although 31% of US family business, they stated that they may have female successor in future. A study by Ernst & Young in 2015 reported that 41% respondents said family members, particularly female family members, have more interest in their business. The rate of women CEO are significantly higher in family business in compared to its non-family businesses. According to Global Consortium by KPMG, published in November 2020, refers that family firm from 33 countries, India is one of the sample in that study, concluded that 18% of the global family business, including India, has women as a leader. This is some data facts about the women in family businesses across the globe. Now let's try to see the great role of women leadership globally. One of the great example of successful woman is coming from Netherlands-based 157-year-old Henkin. Die Waklo, who manages business successfully. Another example is Rainier is an inspiring example who took her father's bankrupt asset and build a large iron ore producer. I say it's not all about getting the business. It's all about, you know, managing and taking it to level one to level two. And she has successfully earned the business and given it to the next generation. The third example again is of Lenzi, the granddaughter of In and Out chain of fast food restaurant in Western United States. Is considered to be the youngest billionaire in the country in 2016. These were individuals who made a remarkable impact on their family business, but I would like to quote a team, a woman team that has made a positive impact, and the examples are Quaden family from Germany, the largest shareholding group of BMW, and Luder family from USA, where 40% members on the board are women and managing their business and family successfully. These are some of the examples. And you will be happy to know in Asia, Lee Kung Kee is the family that has made some changes even in their family constitution and allowed daughters in their leadership role. Now, coming from the globe to the India, I would like to quote your first example is of Kokila bin Ambani, who stood always by husband Dhirubhai, but never joined in the business. But the daughter-in-law, Nita Ambani, joined her husband formally. And the daughter, Isha, joined the legacy family business. Another inspiring story coming from Godrej family, Nisa and Tanya, both have marked positive on their family business. Richika Piramal is taking the business family's legacy forward. Here I would like to quote one of the inspiring case study is Gursimran Mann, managing director of Somboli Sugar, was the first woman in the fourth generation. She takes on the business successfully. Another example of great woman leadership in family business is Annu Aga, the mother of Mayer Padamji, Thermex Group. If you see the recent examples, then we can quote here many examples like Roshni Nader, HCL Technology, Asi Biani, Big Bazaar, Reddy Sisters, team managing the Asia's largest hospital chain, Apollo Hospital, Imami, Max India, Cipla, Lupin, TVS, Asian Paint, Escort, Finolex, and many more are the examples having women in their ownership and key roles in their businesses. On the other side, if you see today in 2021, then the problem is that we have some cases in India where women, as they have not created some provisions in their family constitution and ownership agreement, the women are facing lots of problems. I would not quote their name, but the fact is that women are fighting for their places in their family and in their businesses in absence of their father or their husband. And they are not getting a position in the management team of their own family businesses. Gender inequality great together for women in Indian traditional family business. So what's more important for taking your legacy forward is create your own family constitution and ownership agreement in time. When we are talking about legacy taking forward by women in India, family business, we should not forget Vinit Singhania, the great legacy of J.K. Singhania Cement, who entered into the business after the death of her husband. And she was a housewife for 16 years. Learned the business just from the dining table meeting and telephonic talk of her husband and other family members. You will be happy to know that she led not only her family business, but industry association. She was the first lady president of Cement Manufacturer Association in India. We have many other examples of leadership in crisis by daughter-in-law and daughters who took leadership role because of untimely demise of their spouse. There are Vidhi Chabaria, who managed Jumbo Group, Urvi Piramil, Jyotsna Suri, Bharti Hotel and Hospitality Groups, and many more are there. Because of time constraint, I'm not going to dwell with all the names and facts. Sumati Murarji is something, a new challenge that is taken over by a woman. She is dwelt into the first lady across the globe to head an organization of ship owners, Indian National Steamship Owners Association. She lead it and manage her own family business and manage 6,000 people's group in the business. With this case studies, now we let's see why these numbers are increasing. What's the drivers of women are taking legacy forward? And I found some of the reasons why these women are coming forward and taking the legacy and business from level one to level two. The number one and foremost for me is the education level. Global exposure to the girl child in the family. That's one of the reasons why women are coming forward to take the business and charge in the family business. Very important is you look the last 20 years family size. As family size is shrinking, joint family systems are becoming nuclear and resulting in a fall in the number of male heirs. That's the reason why girls are taking the legacy forward and coming into the front runners position. Third very important change that we have observed is in 2005, that's Hindu Succession Act, which removes gender discrimination and given women an equal say in the family business. And recently, fourth one, that is Companies Act 2013, mandated participation of women in the board. The act played a significant role in increasing gender diversity in Indian family firms. These are the observations why women are coming forward. Now let's see what's the difference between the leadership style of women and a man. What makes the woman one step ahead than a man? Many researches comes and then I found that researchers found that women have unique and transformational leadership style and skills, judgmental and unique outlook that makes them holistic manager and leader. She is the symbolic of purity and faithfulness, submission and devotions. These are the differences of man versus woman in the leadership style. Daughters are coming to the forefront and participating in family businesses with full enthusiasm and zeal. But the reason for joining the business could be varied from family to family. It's the interest of the person, needs, circumstances of the family. However, it is leading to good and welcoming change in the society. My advice to the family daughters who are taking the legacy forward, first and foremost advice is to please connect with your family and first to gain insight about the family sacrifice and learn the reason and values of your family. Learn from your seniors how they have overcome obstacles and know their management style and leadership style. Understand family's expectations, link it with your aspirations. Identify your personal skills and understand the values that you can bring to the table, that to the family and to the business. As a leader, your responsibility is to maintain harmony in the family and sustainability in the business. That is the ultimate objective of any family business success. I like to conclude my talk by saying that role women play in a family business is the family champion, ensuring longevity and fairness among the next generation. Looking to the pioneering role of women in today's family business, her leadership style include collaborative and cooperative, connecting with people, sharing and caring, with high tolerance. And finally, a woman is playing a critical role as a successor in governance, communication, conflict resolution, family leader, a business leader, and ultimately that leads to the sustainability of business. Thank you very much. This is all from my side. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for giving amazing examples. But we already have one amazing example that is with us as one of our panelists. Now I'm extremely happy to invite our next panelist, Ms. Pooja Jain Gupta, a prominent name amongst the young successful Indians in business. As the MD of the Luxor Group, she has been instrumental in diversifying in various businesses beyond writing instruments and stationery, that is real estate, nanotechnology, fiber optics, etc. She is counted amongst the 25 most powerful women in Indian businesses. Indeed, a daughter taking the legacy forward. Ma'am, the stage is all yours. Sir has given us names, and here we have a live person sitting in front of us for the 400 odd audience. All yours, ma'am. Ma'am, you'll have to unmute yourself.
Thank you, Tanu, and Dr. Monica Suri, and Professor Hitesh Shukla, Sonu, and the other panelists, if I've missed any. It's a pleasure to be on this webinar in this current time. Let me first give a clear quote, which I really believe by. Success at anything will always come down to this: focus and effort, and we control both. And I believed in that sentence all my life. I'm not a child who was a single daughter. I'm number 3 out of 4. So for many of my friends and the students hearing this, you're never alone. You need to be focused, and you have to only drive your efforts when you come in a business family as a daughter. Our country is very unique. It has a huge legacy of a male-dominated society. But from the mythology of our Hindu gods, always the Shakti, the Durga, the Parvati, has been the force behind, whether it was Shiva, whether it was Sita for Ram. And I actually believe in the women power. And it has not come to me when I was born, for sure. I was born in a Jain family. My father was a hardcore, self-started entrepreneur with a very humble beginning, began a brand called Luxor, which had 60 years ago, he founded that company. My mother was a great supporter, a lovely wife. She is the chairman of our group now since my dad passed away in 2014. My journey has been working with the group now for 25 years. I started very early. No one asked me to join the company. It just happened that my interest, curiosity, willingness to learn, which still continues extremely high in my character. And I would definitely give that message to all the girls, that your curiosity to learn and continue to grow you have to have the approach of a never to give up attitude. If you continue to learn or you want to learn, you will see the path opening for yourself. It doesn't matter whether you're in the corporate world or you're running a retail outlet, which is also a legacy taking forward from your father. And you are competing with your other siblings in that sense, because the eyes of the parents is always equal for all their children. And there is a possibility that all the children excel in everything they do or they choose to do. But the daughters have to feel the spirit of not giving up, not feeling down when someone tells you something or it's happening like that in many years in the family. Legacy is something which the founders have created in any company, in a small company or a big company, doesn't matter. Whether it is a large FMCG listed company or a group like mine, which is in the mid to large segment, it is all up to us and how we drive ourselves. It is up to us in terms of how we choose someone to take guidance from. I said the word take, not expect that the person is going to sit down and give you a lecture every day. Observation within the family. Observation with who you really admire. You have to admire somebody very strong in your family. Could be your father, could be your eldest brother. And that should give you the inspiration of seeing where you want to take this forward. Then bringing in ideas, always having the ability to speak up, to give your ideas and your point of view. It is not easy in a country like India with so much background and glass ceiling and all those conversations, which I've answered in several media formats. But the reality is that there is a glass ceiling and there is not a glass ceiling. There's a thin line between the two. It is difficult for women, much, much more difficult than men. It is not like Norway, like Professor Shukla mentioned, where gender neutrality is clear. But in a country like ours, still it's male dominated. They expect the son to obviously take the legacy forward. I'm not at all saying that the girls need to become tomboys or they need to go and lash with their brothers or their siblings. It's all up to them of what they want to do, how they want to learn, and the experience of their learning is going to be visible sooner or later by the rest of the family. And that's exactly what happened with me. I admired my father. I was in a very unique spot. I was number third in a family of four with three daughters and one son, and son being elder to me. It was not expected at all for me to have gone to this level and so far. But my entire learning was the admiration of the hero I had, my father, who still lives with me. And also my mother, the tenacity she had all her life as a wife, managing so many fronts other than business. So the support function of a partner was visible to me between my husband, my father and my mother as a husband and wife. And at the same time, I was admiring my dad. Fortunately for me, my father was very open-minded. And wherever he was not open-minded, I made him get open-minded. Whether it was my charm, whether it was the advantage of being a spoiled daughter, or whether it was making sure that you made your father agree without having a rebuking fight or a retaliation. You know, we all have to have common sense. And I think that's the only thing which has to be acted upon at the right time. And I think women have this most innate ability to do multitasking, to be able to observe 5 things, 10 things, 20 things, and then take a call. So nothing was written in stone for me that I have to get into business. And, you know, in 25 years, I'm running this group, which is now almost 2,500 crores in terms of its consumer business and its investments. But what is important is I did not start from the top. I learned from the ranks. I worked with the staff of my father. I worked under them. I worked with them like a normal employee. I never brought in the fact that I was the owner's daughter. And that gained respect in the eyes of my dad to say that this child is willing to give that extra mile with no ego and with no preset mind, you know. So the journey has been a lot of learning, a lot of hardship, a lot of struggle. There have been smiles, there have been laughters, there have been a lot of achievements. There's been a lot of acknowledgement by the outside world. And I'm very humbled by that. I'm very thankful to God to be able to think through this whole passage of 25 years, which I've spent. And I really hope that there are many daughters like me in the future who drive this forward. Even if it's a small business, it doesn't matter. One does not need to give up heart. It could happen that in 1 year you tried and somebody put you down. But it doesn't mean that it's not good, that you cannot try again. It's all about your focus, your determination, and your effort. And all the three have to work in a round circle in connection with each other. You know, I think it has been a fun journey for me. I enjoyed my work. I love my work. I love it with a passion. My father was a very passionate man in his business. I have that passion. I love working with people. I love thinking about the consumer of India. I love meeting people. I love learning from the elder people who have much, much more experience than I have. And I've been fortunate to have that association. But it's not that it just came in front of me, so I got it. I made my effort to come in the front. Leading from the front is not just a sentence which we all use in all CEOs and chairmans, you know, you lead from the front. You have to actually do it. And it's not about a competition between male gender and women gender. It's all in the mind. You have to let your mind not hear and get affected by the statements being made in the family or outside about you not doing the right thing or expected not to do the right thing. Because expectations from daughters are huge. Wanting to get married, showing the boys, arranged marriage, love marriage, the whole story about choosing a partner, your partner should not be like this. More and more restrictions. I got married only 3.5 years ago, and I'm married to a wonderful human being who is my best friend and partner. And that itself was a new learning as well, but nothing stopped on my business side or my bringing me down or doing a different thing after marriage. I could have sat back. I could have done many things which many other, some my other siblings did. They did not work. Clearly, they chose not to. They never did during my father's time. And the hard work, the effort, I always say that, and my father believed it. Lord Krishna said that. You work without thinking about the fruit. You don't have to think what's going to happen tomorrow morning. Am I going to earn that money or am I going to get that award? But things happen. And the belief in oneself and the confidence, we try to say that, yes, we should be confident. We should have that exuberance and the willingness to drive things always. But there are factors which make you down. I'm not saying at all that it doesn't happen. It happened with me many times. But then you have to learn to get up. And the more you learn to get up, the more the world understands that you have an objective and you're focused. And then nothing stops you after that. I think the opportunity in this country now for daughters to move forward, to work within the family, not business only, to work within the family, to identify themselves as a noted person, and not just like one daughter who has to be packed away and get married as a you know, as a Gujarati or a Jain family that I came from. at the age of 18 to 25, they're desperate to look for a boy and then say, okay, we'll get you married to a wealthy family and a good business family, and that's about it. The opportunity this country has with the women who are such brilliant multitaskers, and the opportunity to become entrepreneurs within the businesses you have or even outside, is huge. It's all about being persistent, making sure your efforts are right. And however many times you fall, you never give up. And that's been my philosophy in the last few years. And I have really enjoyed my journey. And I hope to work to the last day of my life, And even when I have children, I don't have children yet, but when I have them, I'm sure nothing's going to change. There will be changes, there will be adjustments, but that's life. It happens, and you can keep continuing and keep growing and keep growing and learning from there. So with that, we can move to the next Tanu speaker.
You know what, Pooja, I'm feeling 20 minutes is less for someone like you, who's actually validated all the points all this while the other panelists have been saying, and you know, particularly I'm very happy that you put certain points, especially the 2 points, focus and control, which are both actually in our hands. And the point that you made is multitasking. I'm sure a lot of questions will follow in the interaction time. But the point that you made of multitasking, I want to pick that point and introduce our next panelist, yet again, a woman who's wearing multiple hats, Ms. Sonu Bhasi, my very favorite, a famous business author, columnist with Economic Times, family business historian, editor-in-chief of Families and Business magazine, one of its types, family business advisor, and also independent director on the board of many national and multinational companies. Her writings are extensively used as academic material in our curriculum at PGD-FMB. And I like to tell this to Pooja, I've been telling her also that we've used her one of the chapters as our case studies and shared that in our classes. We are extremely honored to have you with us, ma'am. And now looking forward to you to address to our audience.
Thank you, Tanu. And thank you, Oro University and Dr. Suri and Professor Shukla. It's my pleasure to be here. I've just been listening to all the speakers before me, and especially Professor Shukla and Pooja. But then I have the advantage of knowing a little more about Pooja because she is part of my first book. But it's just been fascinating to listen to different aspects of women in family businesses. I'm a researcher and a family business historian. So I'm going to actually go back into history and try and figure out why is this there a problem at all about family businesses and women. But before that, many in the audience would have seen a movie, a Hindi movie, not very old one, which to me typifies and is the epitome of how women are treated in family businesses. And that movie is Dil Dhadakne Do. I think that's the name of the movie. It had Priyanka Chopra, it had Anil Kapoor, and the brother, I forget, was whether it was Ranveer or whoever. But that movie actually, to me, was a true depiction of what happens in family businesses. The woman is ambitious. She's talented. She voices her desire to lead the family business. But the patriarch says, nahin, nahin, ye tumhare liye nahin hai. Tum toh ladki ho, tum nahin karoge. The brother is clearly not interested. But because it was a movie, because it is a Hindi movie, everything, turns out fine towards the end. But life is not a Hindi movie. And life does behave like the movie before its ending. While Professor Shukla has named a lot of examples about women who are doing well. And we have Pooja here, and we have, I think, Priyanshi here as well. These are what I call part of that elite 4 or 5% of the entire universe of family businesses. And, you know, they are extremely fortunate. They are extremely, well, fortunate is not the word that I'll use, but maybe they don't realize it themselves, but they are actually role models for thousands and millions of other women, both professional and business owners, because they actually have stepped out and are leading their respective businesses. Now, Professor Shukla went into some bit of reasons why more women are rising in and they're taking charge of family businesses. But I'd like to go back and see why is there a problem? So one is a societal problem that women, of course, have been told through centuries that tumhari jagah jo hai wo ghar mein hai, bahar nikalne ki tumhari zarurat nahi hai, aur ye kaam tumhare liye nahi hai, ye kaam tum nahi kar sakti ho. I've actually through the years of work that I've done in this, I've spoken to a lot of family businesses, patriarchs, matriarchs, inheritors, everybody. And while they haven't said it in so many words, my analysis is as follows. Again, when I ask, we have a large audience here, and I would assume that at least some of them are women. There are at least 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of us here, women. You know, typically in a family, what happens, and it doesn't matter what kind or what economic class family it is, but typically when a woman is about to, or when a girl is about to get married and her trousseau is being prepared and the mother has all her pushteni jewelry and, you know, she takes that out, she gets some more and she gives it to her daughter. But she also says, ki beta dekho ek baat ye suno, ye sab jo hai, ye tumhara hai. Ye jewelry tumhari hai, iska khyal rakhna. And just make sure that your in-laws don't get hold of it. So just make sure that this jewelry, which is your stridhan or this is yours, just make sure that it remains yours and remains in your possession. Now, look at it from the mother's point of view. And again, I'm going back into a typical old family where the wealth of a mother was really the jewelry that she has or she had. And the mother was giving her wealth, her assets to the daughter and saying, iska khyal rakhna, aur ye dekhna ki tumhare matlab sasural walon isko na istemal kare. Now look at it from the point of view of a father. Father ke kya assets hain? And I'm talking of business owners. Father ke jo assets hain, largest chunk is the family business itself, right? So just like the mother is fearful or the mother is possessive about her own assets, which she is willingly giving to the daughter, but she's saying, please make sure that your in-laws don't use it nefariously. The father also has apprehensions. So I'm not condoning the actions of the father. I understand where the fathers have been coming from. Because at the time of a daughter's shadi, typically in a business family, there's enough jewelry given, there's enough property that is given, enough cash that is given. The father does, it's not like the father doesn't want to give assets to the daughter. The father is willingly giving away cash, jewelry, you know, other stuff to the daughter, but he's protecting his most coveted assets because he's afraid that agar shareholding de di, you know, and if the in-laws fall on a bad time or if the in-laws turn out to be not very good, then he stands to lose his precious assets. Now, that to me, that has been the understanding after speaking to a lot of people. And therefore, I understand where the fathers are coming from. However, now with the Hindu, the Property Act and all of that, things are changing. Also, as Professor Shukla mentioned, earlier it was common for, you know, large, well-to-do families to have 5, 6, 10, 11 children. The probability of all of them being girls was very little. So they had to be a boy. So it was understood that the boy is going to take care of the family business. That whole family structure has broken down. Even the most well-to-do families, I mean, the Ambanis have 3 children, the Piramals have 2 children, you look at whichever, they have 2, 3, at most 4 children. And this whole bit of education and access to global education has also changed the views of the who I call are the inheritors. The patriarchs may still remain rooted in their own traditional stuff, but it is the inheritors who, because they've had access to the best education around the world, their whole worldview has changed. And they are aware of examples in other countries where women are taking charge. And also sometimes poor parents don't have a choice because, and I don't mean to be sexist here, please, but you know, if they have only daughters, they either get an outsider to take over the business. Even the son-in-law is technically an outsider, or they make sure that the children, their daughters do well. There are very few examples like we have of Pooja, where in spite of a son being part of a family, it's the daughter who's chosen to work with the family. So this has been, these are some of the reasons that I wanted to share with all of you. Now, looking at coming to the daughters. Now, it's not really necessary that every daughter will have interest in the business. It's okay if the daughter doesn't have an interest in the business. It's absolutely okay. Just like it's okay if the son doesn't have an interest in the business. But if the daughter has an interest in the business, I think the onus is as much on her as much as it is on the father. And it doesn't work in isolation. You can't have only a daughter who's interested and the father who's not interested, or a father who's interested but the daughter's not interested. It has to be an effort of both of them. And if the patriarch does want the daughter to be part of the business, then he has to start the messaging right from childhood. You know, right from the time when the daughter is even 4 years old. I know of family business owners who take their daughters to the office, even to the factories, right from their childhood. It is their way of initiating the daughter into the business. It is their way of getting the daughter to have an emotional attachment with the business. Because unless you have an emotional attachment with the business, you're not going to feel the need to come back and join the business. A lot of patriarchs make a mistake, whether it's with their boy or a girl, is that for the first 14, 15 years of the child's life, they say, beta, beti, don't worry, hum hai na, you don't have to come to the office. Are, why are you spending your afternoon coming to the factory? Jao, you know, be with your friends and, you know, do whatever you want to do. And then suddenly when the child is 16 years old or 18 years old, the patriarch says, acha chalo aao, ab kaam pe aao. And this poor child is totally amazed. Ki bhai, hume abhi tak to bola tha ki jo man mein aaye karo. And now you want us to come and, you know, join you in the business, go to that stupid factory. I don't want to spend my time in the factory. So you know, the patriarch actually cannot blame anybody but themselves if they don't build enough emotional engagement with the business. And because Pooja is part of the panel today, and because she has shared her life story with me, you know, she wanted to spend more time with her father, and therefore she started going and sitting in that hot and dusty storeroom, and just so that she could be there. The father encouraged it, and I think he must have realized that, or he saw that spark of future business leader in her. And it's because her father encouraged her, put her in charge of the joint venture they had with the multinational, gave her responsibility at a young age, that she lapped it up and she kind of took it on. She made the most of it. And for daughters of family businesses who have an ambition, who want to be part of the business, one thing they have to realize is that you have to work for it. I read this little piece somewhere and it stuck with me. You know, they say, I read that, you know, we are taught as children ki gaay hame doodh deti hai, the cow gives us milk. And that little piece said that it's not true. The cow does not give us milk. We have to milk the cow. We have to work. We have to get the milk out of the cow. The cow doesn't give us milk, right? So similarly, if you have, if you want the business, and you know, for a daughter in a family business, you start off with an advantage that if you want, you can be part of the business. But you business aapko milega nahi, business ke liye aapko kaam karna padega. And that is where the responsibility of the daughters come in. That they can't sit there and wait and say ki bhai abhi to hum, you know, we will start, and we will start from the top, and we will have this huge office next to our father, and we will become the bosses. Ban jaoge, magar aap business chala nahi paoge. So therefore, you have to work towards your place in the business. And the good thing is that the world is changing, society is changing, there is more acceptability. So if a daughter wants to join the family business, actually there is no better time than now to start working towards making a place for herself in the family business. I'll stop here because I'd rather answer questions, if any, than go on in a monologue.
Sonu ma'am, even if you continue on the monologue, it's going to be nice. But yes, I understand the paucity of time, and I can also see a lot of comments coming on the comment section, which we will be taking after our next speaker. Ma'am, taking the cue from you, that is starting early, our next panelist is a young entrepreneur from Gujarat who is the vice president of NK Proteins, Ms. Priyanshi Patel. Before I introduce her, I want to first of all thank her that in spite of a COVID situation in her family, she has been patient enough to sit through and be a part. So first of all, thank you so much, Priyanshi, for making it in spite of that trouble. And I'm sure our prayers are there and everything will be very soon all right. So introducing you very quickly to our audience, Priyanshi has been the force behind the launch of the project in her company in Singapore, which was basically aimed towards marketing and business development. She has introduced value-added products in the portfolio of her company, and she has been credited of being the first female president of entrepreneur organization for the Gujarat chapter. We welcome her here today on the session of Daughters Taking the Legacy Forward as a living example of the theme today. So Priyanshi, very quickly with you now.
Thank you so much for having me here. It is always a pleasure to interact with students at Oro. And let's jump straight into it. So I have divided the talk in multiple segments. The first segment, we'll talk about what are the mindsets required. Second is what are the learnings that we need to focus on. The third being how to take the plunge. Fourth is the results and how to deal with them. And the fifth being what comprises of a legacy. So from my experience, these are a couple of points. First is dream of your own legacy within the legacy. Most of the daughters, they're satisfied with helping, or they're satisfied with just thinking that they're going to the office or they're contributing. Ever since I was young, I dreamt of what I would be doing, including how I would want to be dressed, how would my cabin be, how would I be supporting the family. So within that, I knew that I wanted to carve out my own legacy. I wanted to contribute more than just running the business. I wanted to see it survive not just decades, but centuries altogether. So dreaming big was one of the biggest things. So I studied in New York, I went to London, I got a global exposure, which was always encouraged by the family. And that was all just to place the company, not just on a small regional level, but ensure that it spans across India and across the world. So for that, understanding, looking, networking, and learning more about what kind of competition, what kind of industries, or what kind of other companies do we want to mimic? So for us, for our industry, I always looked at Cargill, which is one of the world's largest agri business. So we aspire to someday have so many brands in our portfolios, have, you know, spanned across the, you know, continents per se. So dreaming big on an international scale has always been something that I have followed, and I recommend most of, not just the daughters, but also the son, they look up so that they can eventually reach there. Having pride is very important for family businesses. We've come, as Oro also stands for, values and not just things. So having pride of who we are, what we've become. So that having said and understood from a young age is important. Because you just don't inherit a 4,000-6,000 crore business, or even a 400 crore business. You inherited values. You inherit the trust that people have built in. So keeping those values and being proud of them is equally important. With those, also authentically understanding what are your own personal values. What do you want to bring to the business? And having open and frank discussions with your families, and not just on ideas of strategy, business, finance, but also on how do we want to be, what do we want to represent. So all of those also become very important. For girls and daughters-in-law especially, something which is very important is to emerge from shadows. We always think that we should leave key decisions to the men and just become executors. So, you know, mentally shifting from those shadows and learning how to lead within families becomes equally important. Apart from that, preserving, women are, you know, the reservoirs of wisdom, knowledge, traditions, and cultures. So within companies also, becoming those wisdom and knowledge points is something that I have always cherished. What I've seen in companies and in businesses is you need to prove yourself, regardless of you being a son or a daughter. If you come from a family, sometimes you have to work even harder than the professionals in order to, you know, become worthy of the titles that you're going to have. So being consistent, being dedicated, and sometimes working the most is what helps you establish your position within the family businesses so that you can carry the legacy forward. Moving on to the second part, which is on learning. As I've said earlier, aggressively learning, becoming a researcher, becoming a student of life, every single day is important. Most of the times we walk into the business thinking that we know it all, it runs in our DNA. You know, that's not the case. Becoming learners and observers every day is important. For the first 1,000 days, it's important to silently work, observe, and understand what are the dynamics within the business? What are the dynamics within the families? What are you learning? So as the masters in art said, that if you want to break the rules, master them first. So if you want to make a change, if you want to create a legacy, you have to first understand how things work. Sometimes we get a little restless, especially being in this generation of instant gratification. We want to quickly come in. We want to quickly make our crores or billions. It will not sustain. So it's important first to master everything the way it is happening. And post that, start, as we say, break the rules. Trends, so this is what has helped me personally launch Olixir, was following international trends, and not just within the industry, but cross products, cross industries. So looking at how the world is moving, having the future in mind today. So I read up and I understand a lot about what the future is going to be, especially I think about 2050. If my company, if my brand needs to sustain, then what is it that that world will look like? What would people eat during that time? How would people consume fats? How would they consume proteins? How would that entire chain be like? So understanding them makes us realize what are the key steps we should take today in order to last till then. So when I've been traveling extensively for work in 2015, I saw how the global trends were going towards more a pure wholesome eating. And that's when I realized that the trend will come even to our cooking oil segment. So we were one of the first in the country to start branded premium cold press oils. So during that time, having connects and speaking to the A-listers in Hollywood and in Bollywood as to in terms of what they were suggesting, these stars and the presidents and the vice presidents of the world, is to go back to the roots, to eat healthier, to eat more natural, wholesome food and not processed. So that's when we realized that the trend will eventually start seeping in. So when we started, there were 14 brands around the world and 56 companies that used to press. To today, I think there are more than 60 brands within the city who have cold press oils. But having that position, knowing that back in 2015-16, gave us a lot of advantage in terms of moving in those directions. So understanding where the world is moving, how your industry or your product or your family business will be impacted by global trends becomes very important. Also, one of the most important things that have helped me, which I recommend to most of the students here, is learn. Listen to your family members. Listen to the ones in the senior office in the team. They will give you so much in terms of knowledge, in terms of what has worked over the years, what has not worked. So you do not make the same mistakes. As there's a brilliant saying that, you know, if you learn from someone's experience, you're saving time, resource, and energy, which becomes the most important for you as business owners and leaders of tomorrow to understand. When it is about taking the plunge, when you start working in the family business, there's a chain that I have followed. So the first, as you know, is learn. Second, strategize. Goal setting is very important to strategize, to know in ahead in terms of what do you want to do this quarter, what do you want to do this year, breaking it down into tiny bits and working on it. Third point being action, go for it full force. The fourth point is very important in terms of reflecting what works, what does not work. Being a good leader, according to me, is also listening very, very clearly and understanding what is happening in the ecosystem, how your industry is responding, how your team is responding, how your buyers, customers, your entire supply chain is responding to those. Post that, we make very detailed analysis documented in terms of what happened with those strategies. And then we go back again to learning. So this chain has really helped us move forward and to understand how businesses need to learn. Another most important is results. Especially, I think a lot of daughters in business, when things don't work according to how they've thought, they kind of take a step back. They get disheartened. They feel that you know, maybe they're not right enough or maybe they're not good enough. I would like to say that regardless of where the result goes, especially in the failure, prep again, don't get disheartened. Observe, again, understand more deeply why did it not work. Have points, sit with your team, sit with the family and make your own points. Strategize again and jump again. do not think that you're not right. Everyone who's being successful today, they've all failed in different ways. They've all made some really risky decision and they've failed. So do not get disheartened. Don't let those single instances determine what you can contribute in the future. All of us, again, especially daughters and daughter-in-laws, they have very important place in family businesses because they pour in not just their mind, but their emotions, their everything into it. So do not let those get to you. On the flip side, don't let the success also get into your head. It takes days and days of work in order to stay there. If you've succeeded, do not face down. Go for it full force. Keep working. Also understand why is it that what you've done is working. How quickly your competitors will catch up to it. What do you need to do in order to maintain that position? So keeping a close eye on why you've succeeded. If you're on position one, if something you've done is working, ensure that you work even harder at that point because you'll have to maintain that success. And lastly, legacy. What I believe is legacy is not just the amount of zeros you'll add, isn't about the kind of properties and industries you'll grow, but it's about keeping the intangible legacy intact. We talk about hard work, we talk about dedication, consistency, ethics and morals. I believe those are the legacies that we need to first move forward with. Post that, the zeros and the monetary success will surely follow. Thank you so much for having me here.
Thank you so much, Priyanshi. Those are really, I would say, encouraging and heart-chewing words from your end. So I am so excited and so happy to have so much to ask and interact. I would now open the floor for interaction along with Professor Hitesh Shukla, who will accompany me in this interaction. But I think before we pose our questions to the panelists, I see a lot of comments already coming in the chat and the Q&A section. Let me very quickly address them, and this floor is open to all the panelists whoever would like to answer these. So there are comments. I'm sure the comments can be read by all panelists, but I'll try to focus only on the questions. The questions which I see here is coming from Sushmita Patel, who says that Luxor is the market leader in Indian stationery sector. Please tell us that what makes Luxor so successful. So Pooja, that's the question for you.
Well, Sushmita has asked this question.
Sushmita,
you're right. Luxor is not only the leader in writing instruments and writing and stationery in India, but also internationally from India. It is the largest exporter, exporting to more than 90 countries. What makes Luxor successful? I think Luxor has a strong value system within the organization. The team, in the last few years, after the changeover of my dad moved to me, and before, it has always been a strong foundation company, which is driven by a lot of integrity and passion, which was seen by the founder itself. The brand is very close to the hearts of each and every Luxorian. And each and every Luxor employee, associate, directly or indirectly, even existing or those who have left the company, have actually contributed to that passion and drive which Luxor has built over the last few decades. Our brands, all the brands, Luxor, Pilot, Parker, and Waterman, which are well-known brands in the country, also have seen that being a part of Luxor, the strength the company has is the team and its organizational skills, its quality of product, its innovation, its ability to bring in the market the first product from the marking of markers or highlighters. They were all firsts for the country from Luxor. So it's also led by a lot of vision and innovation, which I personally also drive a lot. That's my take on why Luxor is so successful and considered as a premium brand in the country.
Thank you, Pooja. And I just checked my pen. It's also a Luxor, by the way. Okay, so wonderful. This is a question which I would like to open to everyone here, is that sometimes it comes from a girl or a lady, Deepika. She says that sometimes fathers are afraid to send their daughters to business because they think their daughters are not exposed to cruel side of the world. And they are sometimes afraid to put a lot of pressure on their daughters. So I think what she's asking is about the insecurities that fathers have naturally towards their daughters. So the question is open to everyone, whoever would like to answer. Sonu ma'am, sir, and Sonu ma'am, and then the daughters themselves.
Well, I would like to tell you one story. Recent past, I was in a forest where I've seen some cubs of lion. I was in lion safari, and a lioness was leading three cubs. What she did is, you know, first she took three cubs together, given them the food. Then some other small animals come. We were in a cave observing the lion's life. Then the lioness went out from that group. She was just went behind this tree so that the cub won't see the mother. Now, what is the intention of mother? She was there to protect behind the tree. But the small cubs, they have to fight their own battle. They have to fight their own battle. That's a lesson we can learn from the life of lion. What I have observed here is, as a parent, I should be with my child, but that won't be always with them, that they know that my father or mother is there to protect me. You should know when to leave your child, because ultimately they have to fight their own battle. Right, that's a lesson we have to learn as a parents. And let our children to go and see the reality of the world. Because one day you may not be there. You have to allow your children to face it. And that small battle winning will give them a confidence. And once they will get the confidence, see, this is not important for the cub. That is not important for the children, but also for the empire. You look. When these two great lady who earned the business, when they have took a small decision, it's not the decision that they take. It is the people around them, people in their business, they see that, oh, it's Pooja who took the decision, right? And when the stakeholders see that the Pooja is taking decision on her own, they respect her and they will recognize her as a leader, all right? So the step by step, you have to earn your business. You have to get your own credibility in your business. But it's the right time when your mother is behind the tree. That is not known to you. Thank you very much. I hope I have answered you.
Yes. Anybody else would like to talk about the insecurities that fathers have towards their daughters, and what is the advice that you would like to give? Sonu ma'am, any comments coming from you?
So I don't think that, so, you know, there are many of us who are parents. I'm a parent. And I think it is the natural instinct of a parent to protect the child, whether it's a boy or a girl, from any pain. I have a boy. I don't have a daughter. But all through his growing up years, my first instinct was to protect him from pain. And, you know, how much ever we try to tell ourselves that, you know, any pain that the child goes through is actually helping him or her build character, build resilience. It's difficult as a parent. So while rationally it may be possible for all parents to realize that unless their children are exposed to the real world, they will not be able to survive. But the protection instinct is so strong and especially from parents who are first generation successful. So if the parents have seen hardship, whether building their own business or in profession, where they've had to struggle, they've had to forego a lot of luxury items or creature comforts. Now that they are more financially secure, they certainly don't want their children to go through it. But the greatest service, I believe, the greatest service a parent, whether it's a father or a mother, can do for their children is to let them experience pain right from their childhood, be it playing in the playground and breaking a bone, or with friends, not physical fighting, but going through pain is the greatest lesson in life. And you can't learn from the pain of others. The only lesson that you can learn is when you experience that pain, when you go through that pain, there is no bigger teacher of life than going through pain. So parents, patriarchs, you will do your son and daughter the greatest service if you do expose them to the big bad world right from the childhood. And like that lioness or the tigress or lioness that Professor Shukla mentioned, if you start doing it when they're a child, you at least, you know that you are there to come to their help. What happens that if you don't prepare them and then when you are gone, those poor kids who are now all grown up adults have never had to face pain. And, I've studied maths as my graduation subject. And I do believe that, it's a mathematical probability that you cannot have only good times. Bad times will come. So parents, do prepare your children for the bad times.
I would like to add here, the insecurities, like Deepika has asked, my father had them as well. When I was asked to go to London, UK and Boston at a very young age for training in a very large multinational company, and actually it was huge, and I was going alone. My father had a big, he had agreed to do it, but when time was coming, it was quite difficult. So what I saw in my family, I can just give you one example, is it was constant persistence of mine and my willingness to learn, along with the support of what my mother gave to my dad, explaining him to him that, now the time is coming, let her go. It's okay. She's going to London, she's going to Boston, she's going to live alone, and she's going to work in this big company. You can call her up 1,000 times in a day. But I think a lot of persistence is also required by the daughter who wants to go, not fighting, but in a very calm manner to explain to the father, and also supported by the wife, if possible, to continue to dwell in his mind that it's okay, the heaven's not going to fall, and that insecurity will slowly come down. And that's what I saw in my life, what happened with me.
Yes, I believe starting early has also helped both of you. And there's a question that is posed for Priyanshi, and then there are a lot of questions for Pooja. But first, I'd like to address this question for Priyanshi. Abhay has been asking that, has being an entrepreneur affected your family life? I think he's just trying to understand that how are you managing with your family life and entrepreneurship. Coming from a boy, I think an answer has to be given to satisfy him.
Sure. So I think being an entrepreneur has helped manage my family life better. And I think from the very early years, I knew that I wanted to be an entrepreneur. So I had thought about it in that way. I think in life, it's not just one role being an entrepreneur. Being an entrepreneur talks about how you're being the best possible version of yourself. That is commitment to your own individual self, commitment to your family, commitment to your passion, and also commitment commitment to your community. So it's not just one role that I think I, or as an entrepreneur, anyone has. They have the role to become the best and to set that right example in all these four different areas. So I think I have become, in this journey, a better mother, a better family person. I've become a better citizen of the country. I've become a better entrepreneur and also a better individual.
Lovely. Thank you, Priyanshi. And I think this was a similar question that was asked to Pooja also, that, you know, how do you undertake day-to-day activities as a women entrepreneur? I believe Pooja has answered enough by saying that there is focus and control, that is her mantra. But adding to this, I like to pose this question to both of you and everyone here, which Pooja, you can take the lead, is that Vedanti has been posing this question. This question has come on the chat and the comment section. So I thought I'll just read it out to you. Vedanti says that I've recently started being involved with my family business. And I wanted to ask, how should I tackle older people in the business who undermine me out of their own misogyny and stereotypes?
With patience.
Patience
and not getting affected, not deterring from your focus, listening and not reacting when they say anything, and getting unemotional about the sentences spoken, because it's a learning journey. And not to give up hope.
Yes, so clearly it's a time-taking process.
Yes. It's not that you put the eject button and it's going to be fine. It's not going
exactly
to happen.
And I also personally feel, as being a faculty now in family business, you know, when people say that it's very easy for you, you just have to sit in the chair that is already ready for you. And I always tell them that, you know, it's even difficult for them, because they'll now be in a constant scanner. Everyone, right from the employees to cousins to uncles to father, everyone will now be judging them. So it's going to be difficult. You need to be very patient. And yes, you need to prove yourself. And sometimes you overdo the pressure of proving. But I think patience, what rightly Pooja has said.
And I would also like to say, once you learn in a few years and you gain some confidence by your own actions in the business, then you also have to understand that you can't please everyone all the time. You know, you have to take certain decisions as you go forward. And not everybody in the family is going to say, oh, wow, you know, Vedanti, you've done a great job. You know, somebody will put you down and you have to accept that, and it's going to happen. So the better prepared you are that these negative things can happen, the better, easier it will be for you. But you have to be patient with the older people in the family business who make the comments or try to put you down or are the typical stereotypes, because it is going to happen. It's natural.
Yes, true. Anybody else would like to add on something before I move to the next question, which is a very long question?
I would just like to add on that it is also about influence. So if you're just starting on, please learn, know where they are coming from. Handling business and people is also about understanding people. And the more you understand why they're coming from, where they're coming from, and eventually gaining your own influence over them will help you establish your authority eventually as a business leader. So understand a little better. I think things will become easier as time goes.
Okay, so in the chat section, I have a question from Urbani, yet again for Pooja. She says, good afternoon, ma'am. How was it to work as an employee in your father's company, and how were you eventually promoted? So I think this is coming from the view where, Pooja, you mentioned that you started from ground. No. So there was any scope of promotion? Did it happen naturally, or how was the journey?
So it was very tough. Let me put it that way. I started as an assistant product manager. Started doing the really basic work. I was trained in different departments. I was moved in different departments every couple of years. And yes, my salary bill was also very small. My salary slip was very small, because my father never bothered about, you know, treating my salary slip as a promotion when I'm a daughter and a director on the boards. But one thing I have to say that my father always taught me is, when you enter your office building, you're not the owner's daughter. You are just a normal employee. And if you want to learn and go to the top, that's what you have to keep in your mind with your humility, your head on your shoulders, and not make any wrong comment, because coming out from your mouth can be construed in very many ways. So it was that way difficult and challenging, but promotions were never decided by my father. It was always the professional HR department or whoever, and the boss, because Luxor has always been a professionally managed company. So we had management by objectives, we were evaluated, and it was a regular process, but it was never out of the way. And I didn't even expect it. I was quite happy with the successes I got at that age, you know, and every year there was more to gain, and there was more acknowledgement, and there was more recognition within the organization, outside in the world, by outside people, my father's close associates, families, friends, all seeing me move up the ladder. And I think that was more rewarding than professional kind of salary growth or whatever. But I was very driven as a person, and I am very driven as a person personally. So I never looked at anything, you know, it was always moving forward, and the challenges which came with it, so be it. I just kept wanting to go and persevere always, and focus and efforts were always important for me. I worked almost 12 hours a day when I just started my career. Even now I do.
Yeah, I'm sure.
I enjoyed it. I have to tell you that I enjoyed my work. So that's why.
Yeah, I think
You have to enjoy the work. Yes, that's very true, Mudra.
I think till the time, I also read a line that, you know, you have to enjoy your work, and also your work has to give you peace of mind. Then only is truly your passion. And it's very, very much visible that you're a passion-driven person. There are a lot of questions, but because of the paucity of time, I will be taking just two more questions, one for Pooja, and then there's an open-ended question where there are advisors asked. Priyanshi, I'm extremely sorry. Priyanshi, this is one question for you, which can also be answered by everyone, but this is specifically being asked to you, that have you ever faced any stereotypes? And if yes, then how did you tackle to them?
So stereotypes, I think regardless of your gender, being a male or female, you do face them. And one is when we talk about having the correct mindset from the start, which helps you face them. So one, knowing your own self, what you want to do, how you want to do. Once you have that clearly set within yourself, I think, you know, you do not look at stereotypes. It's as good as someone. So to a man, someone saying you're a woman, of course, it'll not affect them because you know you're a man. Similarly to a woman coming in and saying that, oh, hello, you're a man. So you don't. And you know, you don't consider that. So similarly, the step one is to understand clearly who you are, what you're capable of, what you think about your own self. When you have that clear, no matter who tells what to you, it will not affect you.
Yes, thank you, Priyanshi. I think now this question I like to pose to everyone. That is being advice asked by a lot of people, that what is your final advice, very briefly, for the daughters in the family business? And let me just shift my and pivot a little bit and make it women in family businesses. I think we can start with Sonu ma'am, Hitesh sir, Pooja, and then Priyanshi, and then we'll like to close the session for.
So actually, my advice to women in family is not very different from my advice to women in profession. My advice for women in general is, A, believe in yourself. And especially for women in family, do not take your position for granted. Work towards the goals that you have. I love the word that Pooja used, have patience, because nothing gets changed, especially attitudes, nothing gets changed in a day. But be like that, you know, little dhar of pani, you know, pani ki dhar hoti hai, wo tip 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 karke, wo ek pathar pe bhi wo kar deti hai, usme bhi groove kar deti hai. So you know, do not underestimate the power of persistence. So people give in to you either because they get tired of your persistence or they actually then start seeing the point that you're making. So power of persistence, believe in yourself and never, 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 never use your gender as an excuse, please. Because that will be the greatest disservice that you will be doing to entire womanhood, because then you are just adding to that stereotype. So whatever you do, there's one thing that I would implore you not to do, is do not use your gender as an excuse for anything.
I love this last line, ma'am, and aap Hindi mein switch on kar rahe ho and I'm getting tempted. Aap basically ye keh rahe ho ki dheet banna padega kuch achieve karna hai to. Okay. So next, can we have Shukla sir for this?
Okay, sorry. Just one more thing. Sorry, Hitesh, sorry. For a woman who's aspiring to be a leader, there's one thing from Arthashastra that has stayed with me. I haven't read the book, but I've read excerpts of it, is that a leader has to be comfortable knowing that he is hated. And let me just explain this. Somebody said that, you know, not every decision of yours is going to be a popular one. Not everybody is going to be in agreement with your decisions. And for every decision that you take or not take, there will be people who will hate you. Now, you can either choose to be a popular leader or you can choose to be an effective leader. But as a professional, heading large businesses, every day when I walked into my office, in spite of the smiling faces that I saw around me, wishing me good morning or good afternoon, whatever the time was, I was comfortable in the knowledge that there are people behind these smiling faces who think that I am this is Oro University, I cannot use that word. So you know what I mean. So if I'm comfortable with that feeling, if I am comfortable in the fact that there are people who don't like me, there are people who hate me, then you can become a good leader. You cannot be a good leader by trying to please everybody.
Yeah, I guess even Pooja said this, that pleasing everyone will not be the way forward. So thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. My advice to the next gen leader, whether it's again a boy or girl, first you please understand your family, not the business. Business will come second. Because if you understand your family, family value system, families, you know, people, their struggle, you will develop a respect for them. Why they are opposing you? They are opposing your point. And try to understand their why. Once you understand their why, you try to create a bridge between your aspirations and their expectations. If you can create a bridge between them, I think they will believe in your capability, they will believe in your ability, and they will respect you. Right? That's the one advice I give it to the next gen leader. If you will understand them properly and on your business step by step, they will respect your views, and one fine day, they will accept you, because you are initially working under the shadow. You have to come out of the shadow and you have to be the shadow of someone in your family. All right. That's not easy to leave something for the senior generation, because it's, you know, for family business, it's their baby. They are giving it to you. They have worked very hard and created it for 30, 40 years. That's the legacy that you are passing on to you. I want to ask one question to all, heroes of the day, that what legacy you want to pass on to your next generation, or what legacy you have learned from your family? You know, that's the first question. And then to your next generation, right? That we have to understand. If we understand this, I think there will not be any problem. Generation gap, communication gap. I tell you, in family business, I've worked for last 30 years. All problems are the problems of communication, and it can be solved through only communication. All right. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Communication is the key, clearly. Over to you, Pooja.
So my advice to all the daughters who want to take their legacy, the legacy forward and are aspiring to do something in the family businesses or something else, even outside as an entrepreneur, is, as Sonu also mentioned, believe in yourself, focus, don't give up. And life is a package. It's not going to be a hunky-dory sunlight always. There will be ups and downs. You have to be patient. You have to learn from the elders and their experience and respect that going forward and never give up.
Super. Thank you so much, Pooja. And Priyanshi, we'll have the last word from you.
Thank you. So three things. First, be authentic. Be unapologetic about being yourself. Second is hold the highest integrity. That is what people are looking at. And third, commit to something larger than your own self. So always focus on the larger good. Thank you.
Thank you so, so very much, my dear panelists. You know, I want to, in the end, thank each one of you for such an energizing and engaging session. Thank you for taking our time, for encouraging our audience. Although I see there are so many comments coming in the chat section, but of course, I cannot take the liberty of taking more time, but I tried to do justice to our audience. Thank you, the daughters who are taking their legacy forward and also encouraging a lot of our daughters in the audience to take this for their families. And on behalf of Oro University, would like to extend our thanks to the audience for being so participating and connecting with us all through. Once again, wishing each one of you a healthy and safe time ahead. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you, panelists. Thank you, audience. Thank you so much, Pooja, Sonu ma'am, Priyanshi particularly. After this problem, our prayers and our wishes are with you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Sonu ma'am. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Shukla, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you, audience. Bye. See you for the next talk.